Well, thank you. When I spoke to you a couple of days ago, I was a newcomer here. I've been here for 10 hours. I know I think I'm probably part of the family now. I've been here for 4 days. So we had two new people from HHS join us from CDC, and I gave them one of the toughest trick questions I can think of. Quick, what's the day of the week? And actually, one of them got it right. It's really inspirational being here. When the earthquake and the tsunami first happened and the nuclear issue rose, people were calling me and said, you're going to Japan, and people said, don't go, it's too dangerous. Well, I felt I was particularly lucky to be able to go to Japan. One has the opportunity in these incidents to either run away or jump in and help, and to have the opportunity to actually be involved in helping is a real gift, and I'm really grateful for being here. Part of my, train your whole life for certain jobs, and in some ways, this is it. My background, way back when I started in cancer, was specializing in radiation and chemotherapy-induced cancers. So the impact of radiation on normal tissue and cancer development is something I've been doing for over 30 years. So the issue that I'm going to try to address with you now is, what about the air, food, and water? What is the radiation dose mean for those, and how do we think about those? So the way it works is, people look at, epidemiologists look at those who've been exposed to various doses of radiation, and they try to estimate for the dose of radiation they received, what is the risk of developing a radiation-induced cancer, and they compare that to the baseline risk of your normal lifetime risk is a certain amount, and what's the additional, the excess risk you get from being involved with radiation. And as I mentioned, the first day, 100 rem, which is 100,000 millirem, raises your risk about 10%. And the numbers we're talking about here are really in the millirem range. So you're really talking a bit in the noise about the radiation we're facing right now. Radiation-inducible cancers have a long latency. For radiation-induced leukemia, and this is information you get from cancer therapy, there's a latency of about 5 years. So between exposure and in risk of developing a radiation-induced cancer, it's about 5 years. For the other more common tumors, the risk is usually about 10 to 20 or 30 years. So it's a very, very long latency. So you worry more about younger people because they have a longer potential period of exposure to life than older people. So how the world regulates radiation, I'm not a regulator, is they have what's called protective action guidelines. That what's the dose of radiation that if you get this, it raises your risk of cancer to a level that you should do something about it. And what you do something about is you do interdiction, you stop the source of radiation, the food or the water. Or if you can't stop the source, you relocate people. So the protective action guidelines is what we have. And when we get a radiation reading of a certain quantity, you say, okay, we have this reading in water or food. What if you have sustained this level for a prolonged period of time? What's likely to happen? So the initial reading we got from the water, and it was a single reading of that, so we calculated that an infant would have to drink about 3 liters of fluid a day for one whole month to even reach the PAG you'd have to get, so you'd stop them, you'd have a significant risk of developing cancer. So when you hear these numbers that are slightly above, it usually means that if I sustain this level for years or years or long periods of time, that's when there's really a substantially measurable risk. We compare the radiation we see in the environment to what's normal background. A background is different for different parts of the world, so you have to establish your own background. And what we'll be trying to do with health physicists is to estimate with various models what's the likelihood of plumes going over the city or things being in the water, and taking the potential number you get from that, how long could you stay in a certain area before you actually reach any of the protective action action guidelines. So basically, you can never say anything is safe because there's always some risk. The numbers we're talking about are really just above background. The thing we're hired for, to some extent, is to be designated warriors, and that's my job. We worry about you. We worry about the risk you face. We model things. We see things that are dangerous. We try to issue appropriate alerts. I'm glad to answer any questions now. These are very complicated topics, and again, I am a physician, as I said that before. If someone would like to come talk to me, have questions, we're very happy to do that as well. So again, I'm really privileged to be part of this response, and I really hope we can help make the recovery better for Japan and certainly for the people of the U.S. Embassy. So thank you very much.